We rejoin the Hart family in the mid-1740s in Virginia. Charles is 43 and his son David is 22. They have moved 100 miles south down the Shenandoah Valley to Augusta County. In 1746, Charles works as an overseer of a roadwork project with his son David. Some say he also ran a wagon line between here and Pennsylvania. In 1762, after 30 years in Virginia, Charles and David moved to the Waxhaw region of North Carolina, later known as Mecklenburg County. They probably followed the Great Philadelphia Wagon Road down the Shenandoah Valley, then joined the trading path. Indians had used and maintained much of this path for centuries prior to its use by European Americans. 100 years later, the railroads would follow this route. 100 years after that, it became Interstate 85. Charles received a 250-acre land grant on the Rocky River. David lives next door in the area that became Charlotte, North Carolina. The name of David's wife remains unknown, but we believe they had as many as 6 children between 1759 and 1776. During the next 10 years, we see the Harts in many land transactions along the Rocky River. Both Charles and his wife Clara made their marks on these transactions. Charles was 3 vertical lines topped by a long horizontal line. Clara's was a capital K. David's mark was a capital D. Charles Hart dies about 1771, around 68 years old, just a few years before the Revolution. In 1778, his 19-year-old grandson, Charles, volunteered in the local militia, along with his brother-in-law, Henry. They serve in North and South Carolina, including Wilmington, just before the final battle at Yorktown. Charles served until the end of the war in 1781.
Not surprising, there are no records of the Harts in the years immediately following the Revolution. The next event we have on record is a marriage in 1789.
David Hart II is my 5th great-grandfather. He marries Margaret Blackwelder, the daughter of a German immigrant and Revolutionary War veteran. The next year, 1790, is significant for the Harts, and the records are fairly clear from here forward. President George Washington directs the first U.S. Census, and David Hart is listed in Mecklenburg County, but dies later this year after living in North Carolina for 28 years. All 6 of David's children, some of their own families, migrate west to Kentucky. It's a hard journey. They travel over the Smoky Mountains and through the Cumberland Gap, settling along the Chaplain River in Mercer County. David and Margaret start a family and buy land, as does his brother Charles, the Revolutionary War veteran. Brother Charles lives to be 82 years old and leaves $4,000 in his will to establish 4 school districts in Mercer County, an amount worth almost $120,000 in today's dollars. He was my 6th great uncle. But after only 13 years in Kentucky, David II, Margaret, and their 7 young sons relocate to Bedford County, Tennessee. By 1808, they will have 3 more children. The War of 1812 comes along, and David's oldest sons, Moses and Solomon, enlist to serve under General Andrew Jackson. The 20-year-old brothers fight in the Battle of Horseshoe Bend on March 27, 1814. This U.S. victory in central Alabama largely brought an end to the Creek War. Moses and Solomon returned to Tennessee after the war to find their father David had died. He was only 45 years old and the shortest lived of all my Hart grandfathers. Charles Hart was my fourth great-grandfather. He was named after his grandfather, the one born in Germany. He marries one of Joseph Wagner's daughters in 1820. Around the same time, his brothers Solomon and Anderson also marry Wagner daughters. Charles and his wife have three kids born in Tennessee in the next 6 years. In 1826, after 36 years in Tennessee, the Harts continue their migration west. Solomon, Charles, and Nathan cross the Ohio River and settle near Jacksonville, Illinois, a small town in Morgan County. The three brothers spend a few years obtaining land through grants and purchases, and soon David III and Anderson leave Tennessee and join their brothers along this western frontier. Moses, Caleb, and their sister Elizabeth will remain in Tennessee. Daniel will eventually settle in Missouri. By 1832, Charles is the father of six. He is also a member of the state militia, along with his brothers David, Nathan, and Anderson. This militia was formed to fight against the Black Hawk Indians in northern Illinois. They deploy that spring to the Mississippi River for about 6 months.
While they are fighting, federal soldiers from the east pass through the Harts' hometown on their way to participate in the war. Ironically, by the time the federal soldiers arrive in the area, the war is over, but they leave a major outbreak of cholera in their path. 50 residents die in the epidemic over the next year, including the two Wagner sisters married to Charles and Anderson. 47 families moved away that summer.
The Hart brothers returned from the war and moved to the southern part of Morgan County to make a fresh start.
They found a fine belt of timber on an island lying between Big and Little Apple Creeks. Here they built their cabins. After each had secured land, Solomon securing 3 80-acre tracts of the best timber. The remainder of his capital he invested in prairie land. They called it Hart's Prairie. Washington, David III, and Anderson subsequently joined them.
Six of the nine brothers are now living on Hart's Prairie. Solomon, the oldest, is 42, and Anderson, the youngest, is 29. Charles, a widower and father of six, remarries on April 30th, 1835, to Eliza Matthews. They have seven children by 1846, and continued to farm on Hart's Prairie. These golden pioneer days are chronicled in several biographies and local histories of Morgan and Macoupin County.
One day in 1846, I was seeking a school in which to teach. I met Charlie Hart plowing his field. Charlie stated that there had been three spells of wet weather over 3 years, and the wet weather seems to never stop. Charlie suggested that he might shingle his whole farm. From the March 1st, 1907 Journal Enterprise.
It must not have all been great, but can you imagine Hart's Prairie in 1846? Six pioneer brothers with a total of at least 50 children living on adjacent farms on the western frontier. They had fought their way from Kentucky to Tennessee and again in Illinois, where they were all prospering. Why would you ever want to leave? For the most part, they didn't, except my fourth great-grandfather, Charlie. On February 9, 1846, Charles and Eliza donate the land for Hart's Prairie School and start making their plans for a big change. The urge to keep moving west must have been gnawing on Charles. They decide to go to Texas. Charles gets ready to leave behind five brothers who stay at Hart's Prairie the rest of their lives.
Solomon had 10 children who all lived to be adults. He lived to be 82 years old and cast his vote in 14 presidential elections.
Washington was well known as a captain in the state militia, lived to be 64, and had four children.
David III lived to be 81, had 11 children and 83 grandchildren. He was known as a tremendously strong man and weighed over 300 pounds.
Nathan lived to be 75, had eight children, and owned land in both Morgan and Macoupin counties.
Anderson had 11 kids and lived to be 66.
After 20 years in Illinois, Charles, now 51 years old, sells the rest of their land for $1,300. Charles chooses Springfield, Illinois, the largest nearby town, to organize his wagon train and buy supplies. They use teams of oxen pulling sleds for the 750-mile journey to Texas. Charles and Eliza travel with their 13 children, ages 1 to 27. Several other families also join the wagon train. But why did Charles and Eliza pick Texas? Ransom Pryor Hart was my third great-grandfather. He goes by Pryor. 6 years earlier, we find Pryor off on an incredible adventure in East Texas and involved in a feud during the Republic of Texas years called the Regulator-Moderator War. Pryor was a signatory to an 1842 letter to the Texas Congress requesting aid on the Republic's eastern boundary. The war started out as a dispute of land ownership before becoming a violent conflict for control of the local economy. The U.S. and Spain ignored a strip of land between Spanish Texas and the Louisiana Territory because they were unable to agree on the boundary and they didn't want to go to war over it. The area developed into a lawless patch that neither country controlled. The Republic of Texas Congress finally stepped in and ended the conflict in 1844. Pryor survives the war and travels west to Fannin County, north of present-day McKinney. The area was about to be available for settlement and land grants. He is there long enough to be enumerated in an 1844 census. The region is known as the Wiregrass Prairie.
The area was void of fences, bridges, or roads, except wagon trails. The prairie was populated with deer, antelope, buffalo, bears, cougars, panthers, wild hogs, turkeys, and prairie chickens, from Fading Moments recorded.
I think Pryor wrote home to his father about this new frontier and the black soil that looked so fertile. Pryor probably traveled back to Illinois around 1846 to find his father eager for a new start and glad to have his son's help leading the wagon train. 1846 was a big year for the famous wagon trails out west, the Oregon Trail, the Santa Fe Trail, and the Mormon Trail. But there was no major trail to Texas from Illinois. Charles would have crossed the Mississippi River at St. Louis, then made his way to Fort Smith, Arkansas. He probably avoided Indian territory, crossing the rivers near present-day Texarkana, and arriving in Texas in the spring of 1847. While much of the country was caught up in the California Gold Rush of 1848, Charles and Pryor Hart were busy being the first white settlers of North Texas.